Hey guys, Alan here. Today I'm going to show you how to install Backburner Manager in a minimal CentOS 7 virtual machine. This machine is going to be dedicated to running the manager, and that makes it highly reliable and pretty quick. A lot of times people will use their local flame or maybe one of the flames in the building as the master Backburner Manager, or even worse, they'll follow the Autodesk guidelines and set up a full workstation class machine just to run the Backburner Manager, and that's a huge waste of resources. So we're going to do this in Proxmox. It's a virtualization environment. It's open source, it's free, it's very reliable. I've been using it for years. There's several other virtualization environments you can use, from VirtualBox to VMware to Xen, KVM, roll your own. Whatever you choose, I'm going to do it in Proxmox. The philosophies all stay the same between all the different products. So one thing you need to do is make sure you go to CentOS.org and download the latest minimal install. Hold on. Okay, so I'm going to create this VM, and I'm just going to give it an arbitrary VM ID. That's going to be different for your platform, and I'm just going to call this manager test. Here in Proxmox, we want to make sure we click start and boot, and also the QEMU agent. And then, oops, can't have a hyphen there or an underscore. Okay, so then the OS, you're going to choose your OS install. This is that ISO, that CentOS Minimal ISO. And switch to the hard disk. I always use the VirtIO block. And this is a really small minimal install. 6 gigs is going to be totally fine for what we're doing. And CPU, I always give it 2 CPUs and make sure that we choose the host type for the CPU. So this basically kind of passes off the raw feature set of whatever CPU is in the actual virtualization host, as opposed to mimicking one of these types of CPUs. We just want it to be just straight into the CPU. And then for the install, I'm going to give this 2.5 gigs. We'll back that down later after the install. I'm running on some VLANs, so I have to put in my VLAN ID, but depending on your network infrastructure, you might not have to do that at all. Okay, so let's see where I made that. Here's this. Virtual machine, and now it's finished being made. And now we're going to go to install CentOS 7. All right, so most of this you can just continue straight through. And first thing you want to do is give it a host name. So we're just going to call this manager test dot instinctual dot local and hit apply. And then you have to turn on the network. All right, and by default, it's going to do a DHCP address. You definitely don't want that unless you do an address reservation. So I'm just going to manually set this IP address here. And then the DNS. These are all things you need to know for your own network. None of that is going to... it's going to be different for each one of you guys there. Okay, so we have our static IP address set and a host name. Go here to done. Now go here, select your time zone. And and just go here. Again, we don't have, because it's such a small disk, it's going to automatically choose a partitioning scheme that is appropriate for what we're doing. I always disable the kdump because I really don't care about kernel dumps. If it crashes, just reboot. I'm not going to be looking into why it crashed. And for the password, go here, set your password. I'm just setting this to the default password for this exercise, but of course it's recommended to set your own. Don't have to go here to user creation and leave that alone. You can see that the password is now set. When you go in here, if it's a stupid password like this, you're gonna have to double click done twice. See here, so you have to click twice on done. If you give it a good password, it will make you do that. And while that's going, I'm just going to open up a terminal shell because I'm going to need that. And if I remember properly, I believe I set the IP address to 241. Could have been 244, but we'll see when it comes up. So the other thing, again, while this is going on, you want to go to your folder where you keep your installers for Flame. And go to the dist, the IST folder, and you want to grab these three files here. Autodesk Backburner Monitor, Backburner SW Base, and Linux Tools SW Base. You can either just copy them into a separate folder. I've done that here, so I'm going to close this out in a second. Or just remember them, and I have a list here. So I've copied them to this little folder called Manager, and on a Mac, I like to use Transmit. We're going to use that to transfer those files over to this new virtual machine when it's done. So this Autodesk Backburner.monitor, Backburner.sw.base, and Linux Tools SW.base, that's all you're going to need. All right, so that's done. We're going to reboot. And now that we have finished the install, I'm just going to essentially eject that media here, that ISO, which is fine. And let's just log in as root here from the console and check the IP address, and we're at 244. Okay. And the reason why I'm logging in via the terminal, not the console, is can't copy and paste here. This is kind of more like, well, I don't know, whatever. It is what it is. This is an actual shell. Okay. So kind of log in as with the password, and we're going to run this. This first command disables SE Linux. We don't need that. And this disables the firewall, because in theory, your machines on the production network are already protected, and if they're not, then you have bigger problems than this. Okay, so first you want to run yum update. That's going to go through, find all the things that are new, and then it's going to prompt you whether you want to continue. And again. Okay, so that's all done, and you definitely want to make sure you reboot after the yum update. And you'll see that it comes up pretty fast. Alright, so it's up, and we're going to go log in. And now you have to install this ancillary stuff. And in regards to QEM guest agent, see here how it says there's no network information? Well, the QEM guest agent is going to provide that. So once it's installed, you should see it fill in with the appropriate IP address. It might need a reboot, but that's why we do it. So the hypervisor and the virtual machine guest talk to each other. Okay, now you're going to enable these items here, and then we need to transfer these three RPMs to the virtual machine. So I'm going to type that in, signed up there. So since I logged in as the root user, that's going to the home of the root account, and then you install these RPMs. Now, see here how it's telling me the fully qualified domain name. I have not registered that with our DNS server, so when I go to test it, I'm going to use the IP address. Also, just for good measure, I'm gonna reboot this one last time. All right, guys, I rebooted, and I realized there was one step I forgot. So, and I had to change the IP address just to confirm that, so you may have remembered we were going to 244, now we're going to 246. This is a really important step. You need to edit the hostname file and remove the fully qualified domain name unless you're running a proper DNS server. If you're running a proper DNS server, you have to make that entry into your DNS. If you're not running a DNS server, then you have to do this. You have to remove FQDN and leave just the host name like this. So we deleted the instinctual.local, which is our domain. We're leaving just the host. So once you do that, you have to reboot, and then we can move forward. So to test this, I'm just gonna go here to Chrome and go to 246. Oops, sorry, 246. And you can see we're now at our web prompt. Go to Backburner Web Monitor. Again, this is because you don't have, or we don't have, a proper SSL certificate. It's totally fine. You just skip through all that stuff. And then when it says get flash, it's a little bit misleading because Chrome already has it. So you just click that to allow. And in a moment, there we go. And now you see we have two managers listed. This is our real manager, the one that we use for production, and manager test is what I just set up. And you're good to go. We've been running a manager like this for almost 4 years. It's been really stable and reliable. We almost never, I mean, like maybe one or two times a year, have to reboot it because of manager problems. It's usually a flame problem, not a manager problem. And it's very lightweight and fast. So you could see here that, let's see how much memory we're using. Right now, this manager is using just under 256 megs of memory. And that's pretty much, technically it's really only using about 100 megs of RAM. It's pretty much all you need. It doesn't take a lot. So that's that. Hope it helps.